This is The Arm of the Starfish by Madeline L'Engle, Chapter 16. Callie, already changed to a scanty black bathing suit and a white terry cloth beach robe, was waiting for him in the lounge. "Come on, and I'll show you where to dress," she said. "We'll swim in the ocean, not the pool. I want to be sure we aren't overheard. Hurry up." She spoke quickly, quietly, nervously. As Adam changed to the plain navy blue trunks, he remembered Polly's gift. He took it out of the box and looked at it, a canvas belt with a holder for what looked like an ordinary knife. He took the knife carefully out of the sheath and inspected the mechanism for triggering the blade. He couldn't check the blade for the vein filled with MS-222 without releasing both blade and chemical, but it looked as though it would be perfectly simple to manage. Although Adam had never owned a switchblade, he had seen several, and he knew how they worked. He shrugged and put the knife and belt back in the box. If he wore the belt, Callie's keen eyes might spot it, and the evening was complicated enough already. He did not worry about needing the knife. Polly was an imaginative kid, still frightened from the kidnapping experience. And Typhoon Cutter would hardly allow Callie to swim in dangerous waters. Then, with his hand already on the doorknob, Adam swung around and went back for the knife. At the corners of his mind, he felt that something was wrong with the evening. It seemed as though he had done exactly what he had set out to do, but he had an uncomfortable, nagging feeling that somewhere, somehow, he was being stupid. And a promise is a promise. He had promised Polyhymnia that he would not go swimming without the MS-222, and even if it were not for that small worry at the edge of his conscience, he would have had to honor that promise. He strapped the belt around his waist. The sheath was tapered and made a very little bulge under his trunks, which were slightly loose for him in any case. Then he went to join Callie. She was waiting at the edge of the big pool, herself in a pool of golden floodlight, which made her tan glisten. Her black bathing suit was sleek against her supple curves and cut more deeply in the back than Adam would have thought possible. As she saw him walking down the path toward her, she picked up her robe and ran to him, taking his hand. "See why we can't swim here? The pool is full, and I don't dare trust anybody. Daddy has an enormous organization, and I don't know half the people involved in it, though I thought I did." Across from the pool, the tennis courts, too, were floodlit, and a game of singles and a game of doubles sounded in the night. The ping of a ball against the clay of the court. There was calling and laughter from the pool. Ahead of them, the ocean lay dark, and its murmur was almost lost in the light and sound about the hotel. As they got to the long ramp leading to the beach and out of the glare of the floodlights, Callie seemed to relax. She held Adam's hand lightly instead of clutching, but her voice was still wrung with tension. "Oh, Adam, everything's so awful." She moved closer to him, seeking, it seemed, the strength and comfort of his body. "Adam, oh darling, darling Adam, can I trust you?" "Trust me how?" he asked cautiously. They had reached the end of the ramp and stood on the night beach. Callie let her robe drop to the sand and turned to Adam, putting her arms tightly around him, leaning her head on his shoulder. "I need your help so terribly." The light fragrance of her hair brushed against his nostrils. Callie, despite her sophistication, was just as vulnerable as Polly. She might be a few years older, but she was just as helpless against the powers of evil that surrounded them. "How do you mean me?" he asked gently. Callie lifted her head and looked at him. The moonlight fell full on her so that her skin was milk white and her lovely features seemed chiseled out of marble. Eyes were imploring. "Adam, I know you have no reason to trust me. I wouldn't blame you a bit if you just rejected me now. But please don't." "I'm not rejecting you, Callie." Let's just sit down a few minutes before we swim, and I'll tell you as quickly as I can all the awful things I've done because Daddy told me to and everything. She led the way along the beach, back through the soft sand to the foot of a high dune. Here she sat down, pulling him after her, and lay back. You can wash the sand off him and go in for a dip. Adam, what would you do if you discovered that your father was doing things that were wrong? This was something Adam could not possibly imagine. If he had to choose one word to describe his father, it would be integrity. So he answered, I don't know. He did not add, because it would never happen. But Callie must have caught the unspoken thought. He used to think Daddy was perfect. I thought that no matter what he did, as long as it was Daddy who was doing it, it must be right. But now I know. She stopped with a sudden intake of breath. I can't tell you anything unless you promise me something. I shouldn't have said this much. For a moment, caution returned to Adam. What do you want me to promise? Oh, nothing difficult. I don't want you to do anything or anything. Just promise that you'll never, never, never say anything to anybody in the world about what I'm telling you. Why would I want to say something? Callie sat up, looking down at him broodingly. Adam, I know now that O'Keefe and Talis and their people are right. Daddy's wrong. I'm sure you know it too. You might want to tell them, O'Keefe and Talis. But I'm not going to tell you anything they don't already know. I wouldn't put you in a position where it would be your duty to tell them, I promise you. But I couldn't bear, please, Adam, promise me you won't tell them. Maybe it's just a matter of pride. I still love Daddy, you see. He's still my father. So please just promise me you'll never tell. I can't work for O'Keefe or Talis or anything. I can't work against Daddy, even. So please, please promise you'll never tell any of them what I've told you or what I'm going to tell you now. She flung herself at him, pressing her face against his shoulder so that he could feel her tears hot against his flesh. All right, I promise, he said, stroking her back gently as though she were Polly. She heaved a great sigh of relief. Thank you. Thank you, Adam. Daddy only returned Polly to you to get you to work for him. I guess you know that now, anyhow. Yes, Adam said. And I know Daddy's asking you to work for him again. Adam didn't say anything, and Polly continued. I'm not going to ask you about that. That's your problem, and you have to handle it whatever way you think is right. I know it'll be the right way. Maybe you don't trust me, but I trust you. Implicitly. She paused. So Adam mumbled, thank you. You're supposed to go to Lisbon this week, aren't you? Yes. And you're supposed to meet me? Well, yes, you know that. On Friday, isn't it? Yes. I know about the plans, of course, because Daddy doesn't know I know about them, and I could never let him know. He might, Adam, he might hurt me. I know now that all he wants is more money and more power, and he doesn't care who's hurt as long as he gets them. There are people in China, for instance, who are willing to give Daddy almost anything he wants if they can get a hold of O'Keefe's findings. They think people are, what's the word, expendable, and so does Daddy. It isn't anything as simple as communism versus democracy. It's power pitting itself against power. So I'm trapped in the middle. By Friday, I ought to know more what I have to do. So if we can just pretend to play along with Daddy, and it will be just pretending, we can meet in Lisbon and things ought to be clearer by then. The main thing is that you have to keep your promise, Adam. You must not tell anybody, not anybody, anything I've told you. I'm not in the habit of breaking promises, Adam said. I know you're not. But you see, a promise simply doesn't mean a thing in the world to Daddy. He'll promise anything in order to get what he wants and break it the next minute without a thought. So I just have to make extra sure. It isn't that I doubt you. You're the only person in the world I trust. Sorry, Callie, Adam said, helplessly. Callie was lying back against the dune, her fair hair spread out on the sand. The moonlight fell full upon her beautiful face and body. He felt a profound longing to protect her, to rescue her from the evil that held her in thrall. She whispered so that he could hardly catch the words. Thank you. For what? For being you. It was the best day of my life when our planes got held up by fog and I met you in the airport. She turned her face toward him, then reached out and touched him gently on the cheek, moving so that she was closer to him. Very lightly, she put her lips against his, then, abruptly, cutting his response, she jumped up, saying, "That isn't fair of you. Come on, Adam, darling. Let's have a quick dip, and then you'd better get back to the O'Keefe's." Like a naiad, she ran swiftly across the sand and into the water, and he followed her, splashing through the waves. The moon was high and the ocean quiet. It was not long before they were beyond the breakers and into the rhythmic swells. Callie rolled over on her back and floated, staring up at the moon. "You see, Adam, I think I can help you now. You can't work against Daddy. You do understand that. But I think I can help you to not... help you not to work against O'Keefe. It won't be safe for you to call the apartment when you come to Lisbon on Friday, so we'll have to arrange to meet somewhere. We could meet for lunch, couldn't we? That would be perfectly normal, wouldn't it?" Adam, too, was floating, letting the water ripple gently against his body, slap lightly on his cheeks. "That's pretty much what's expected, I think. Someplace large and obvious would be our best bet. There's a good seafood restaurant, the Salao de Cha. Anybody can tell you where it is. Meet me there at 1. "Fine." Adam looked up the moon. He thought of Joshua and the little plane flying straight along the path of the moonlight, as though he were heading toward the clear, cold light of the moon itself. "I'm so jittery about everything, I could just jump out of my skin. Let's have a race." She flipped over and faced out to sea. "What about undertow and stuff?" Adam asked. "Oh, Adam. Sorry, but I've learned to treat the ocean with a good deal of respect." "For goodness sakes, Adam. I'm as used to this beach as I am to my own bathtub," Adam asked, doggedly. "What about sharks?" "That's nonsense. Daddy says it's just a malicious story made up by people who like to see the hotel lose business. Come on, I'm going. And if you're scared, you can go into shore and wait for me." She thrust her body forward in the water. After a moment's hesitation, Adam followed. Callie swam easily and well, and she had a head start. Adam was stronger, his arms and legs longer, but he had to work to catch up with her. Just as he drew even and began to forge ahead, he heard Callie scream. They were in the path of the moonlight now, and in the water beside them, he could see a large, dark body. He felt a moment of cold blankness. Then, almost without thinking, he reached for the knife Polly had given him.